I come from a family with some bad stories around food. My dad spent most of his adult life from 250 pounds up to 350. So these right two categories, a BMI of 35 to 40 and then higher. How did he get there? He loved sweets, but it wasn't just sweets. It was just piles and piles and piles of food. My mother actually got up over 160 at one point. So here's one of the, and I got up over 190. I'm currently 155. And what has all that got to do with heart attack and stroke health? Obviously a lot. And that's the battle that I routinely fight. I have... as a young adult in college, I got up to 190. Then I decided I needed to lose weight. Went on more of a low fat, plant-based diet. Got down to about, have actually for the most part of my adult life, gone between 155 and 160. I have been over 160 a few times. A few years ago, got up to 170. Now, it's an interesting thing. What has that got to do with CIMT? With my CIMT, it has to do with a lot. And we'll go through that over the next few minutes in this video. My arterial age tends to be driven to a large extent by my BMI. And I'm not alone. That's a key item. I get a lot of grief for being so aggressive about BMI and body fat. As you may know, and if you're saying, well, BMI is not exactly body fat, I know that. But if I inserted RFM, relative fat mass, and every time I said BMI, nobody would, even fewer people would understand what I'm trying to say. So I'm referring to body fat mass or relative fat mass. Fat does cause some things that challenge your insulin, your body's response to insulin, and therefore your routine sugar values, glucose values, therefore also some plaque values. And that is where the connections start to get made. There's a strong case that insulin itself drives a lot of this plaque as well. And that's not what this video is about. This video is just starting off making that connection between body mass or relative fat mass and CIMT results. Now, as you start looking at my CIMT, one of my early videos, I covered my early experience with CIMT and made a case that despite having stayed around, actually, for the most part of my life, as I said, in the 150s, 160s, I had gained weight as I got older. I started getting that middle-aged spread. I was playing 2 hours of basketball, full court, twice a week, plus a half marathon once a week. So I was running too much distance for a 50-year-old. And I also decided to bulk up a little bit to be able to bump people around on the basketball court. it was after one of those events, one of those two-hour activities that I remember thinking about it and praying and saying, you know what, if I get too fat and start having some heart attack and stroke risk, maybe I can start sharing some of this with the other folks that are Gray Panthers or folks that are beginning to become Gray Panthers. I still expected, though, after getting my first CIMT to do a victory lap because, again, I was not eating unhealthy food, again, plant-based, although significant carbs. That was in February of 2015. I was 57 years old, and I had an arterial age of 73. At that point, and I also had some plaque, by the way, at that point, it motivated me. Here was the representation of that plaque, 1.49 millimeters heterogeneous plaque in the right common carotid. I bit the bullet. despite being very anti-medications, especially on the statins topic. I decided to go ahead and start statins. A couple of years earlier, I had developed high blood pressure. I'd been on losartan for a couple of years. That's an ARB. Switched from the ARB to an ACE inhibitor, ramipril, and started statins. I bumped around from simvastatin, pravastatin, and then as the price continued to drop on Crestor, I went to rosuvastatin or Crestor. Now, I got very deep. I started a more of a concierge practice and started doing more of these CIMTs. I was able to get them done every month because they'd come in to be done for my patients, and I'd say, hey, while I'm here, let me hop up on the table. I saw a very interesting and very nice pattern, linear pattern of a drop. You can see that pattern here in the nomograms. In October of 2015, just what, 8 months later, I had dropped 14 years from 73-year-old arteries to 59-year-old arteries. In another October to September of 16, another 11 months, I dropped 7 more years. These are nomograms down here. These are basically how those numbers of years are calculated. The arterial age is calculated. You see, there's population norms for intima-media thickness testing, starting as early as age 5. The pink line is women and the blue line is men. Men tend to lay down a little bit more oxidized LDL inside the artery walls. If you don't understand IMT, intima-media thickness test, or LDL, or oxidized LDL, that would be too much of a digression for this video. So when I did that video, it was at one point my giving my devil his due, meaning actually admitting that, yes, lifestyle is very important, but especially when for the first few years that you start statins, they can be very impactful as well. And if you go in and you look at the statistics, statins do have a pattern of decreasing plaque during those, especially those first couple of years when plaque has just been laid down recently. Now, let's fast forward to another couple of years, April 2018. So actually that was what, another 6 months after 16 months after September 2016. I was continuing to do these CIMTs because of the practice at that point, but I just did not save any of my values. I did an event at the COIS Center in April of 2018 with my friend Doug Thompson. By that point, I was starting to work full-time in the Medicare Advantage space. It's very exciting for me because it's an area where Medicare is actually beginning to adopt preventive techniques. So I became chief science officer for a group of docs, about 700 to 800 docs, who are focused on prevention in the Medicare world. If you think Medicare Advantage is for poor populations, it's cheap, it doesn't give you selection, you need to be thinking again. All of the other insurance types, private insurance, Medicaid, all of the major insurance groups are headed much more in that Medicare Advantage route. And you shouldn't see that as a bad thing. Anyway, that's a digression. I'll stop that. Let's go back to my own scan results and what happened with me and my scan and my plaque. Now, this one is 28. I still had maintained my weight. I had not started into that full-time travel and weight gain. So I was still like 155, still about the same, a right common carotid plaque in the right common carotid artery. Plaque for these terms, discrete plaque, is labeled as anything over 1.3 millimeters. So you see I have several other numbers in here. Right common carotid artery 0.8, left common carotid artery 1.0, but they don't have a letter next to them. The reason they don't have the letter is that, again, it's not 1.3 millimeters or higher. Where did we get that number? Again, from the research. If you go through the research, it's those discrete plaques that are 1.3 millimeters or peaks that are 1.3 millimeters or higher that contribute to your overall cardiac event risk, cardiac and stroke event risk. Now, so heterogeneous, that's the next question. There's no question as you watch the progression of these things. Soft, you can see them, and that's the soft, inflamed, hot plaque. Echogenic is the calcified plaque. And despite what you may hear about calcification in arteries, calcification overall is a marker that this plaque process has been going on, and you've been going through the cycles of getting inflamed, laying down soft plaque, and then stabilizing it, and maybe getting inflamed again, softening that plaque again. But there's no question, echogenic plaque is stable, and that's what you want to have. Now, what is heterogeneous, or H? It's in between the two. So, if you look at my discrete plaque peak values, that's what where they are in at the COIS Center in April of 2018. Now, in comes working for full time in that Medicare Advantage environment, traveling every week, and I gained 10 pounds. I went from 155 up to 165. And I had an increase in my arterial age. It went from, this is March 2019 at the Healthy Life Summit in Orlando. And I went from an arterial age of 52, 53 up to 58. So that's an increase of 5 years. I didn't go back to the 73-year-old number that I had back 5 years ago. But I have to watch my weight. If you look at the actual peak values, those discrete plaque numbers, they really did not change that much. This was really a risk that was driven more by common carotid artery mean or arterial age. If you go back and you look at these discrete plaques, the right common carotid artery still had a 0.8. The bulb still had a 1.6. It was still heterogeneous. The internal carotid was still 1.1. On the left, common carotid was 0.9. It was 0.1 before. 1.0 before. 1.0 to 1.1. Again, not significant changes. If you look at total plaque burden or average CCA max region or mean max, those really did not change significantly. What changed? My arterial age. Why did it change? You know, some of this, I have no question, some of this could have been variation from the technique of the ultrasound tech, what we call the interrogation, because I've done other videos to show you how just a few degrees difference in the orientation of the ultrasound wand can result in significant changes. But that's for another video. These cardiorisks were done by Todd Eldridge's group, and Todd does about the best job I've seen in the country on being able to filter out all of that noise and give us reliable numbers. So I got focused on full-time work, travel every week, eating too much. I gained 10 pounds and my arterial age went up. I've lost most of that. I'm back to about 155 again. We'll see over the next few months what the impact is on my CIMT and my arterial age. If you've made it through this far, thank you again for your interest.